But, and then I think about God, and he looks down at his children, and he sees us fighting over the stupidest things. They sat in my spot in church. That's my pew. They should have known those. Where I always sit. Or they walked in and they started talking to that person who completely ignored me. Didn't even shake my hand. And we start over the smallest things, get offended, and we build up walls. And we can't get along. And we have churches that divide. And we have churches that separate over the silliest things. The color of the carpet. The color of the walls. How loud the music is, or how it's not loud enough. And we fight over these things all the time, and God's up there and he's saying, can't you just get along? I want you to get along. The third reason why he wants us to love each other is it's practice for eternity. We're going to be with each other forever. And Pastor talked about that a couple weeks ago. He said, you know, why is it when we're born, God doesn't just take us right up to heaven right away. Skip this whole mess that we call earth and all the problems we have to deal with. Just take us. The reality is we're not ready for heaven yet. And we got to learn to start getting along down here. If we can't get along down here, I seriously sometimes doubt whether we're even going to make it. And there's scriptural basis for that. Whether we would even make it to heaven if we, as brothers and sisters, can't love one another down here on this earth. And we're going to get there in a little bit. Alright. So our second purpose in this life is fellowship. Our first purpose was worship. Our second purpose in this life is fellowship. Fellowship's one of those words, it's kind of, you might get a different definition depending on who you talk to. If you want to ask somebody, hey, what's fellowship? If you're somebody that's grown up in church, you might say, is it just something as simple as, hey, going to church. Going to church is getting my fellowship on. I'm getting with brothers and sisters, that's fellowship. Or you might say, no, it's not the church thing, it's after church. We all know, especially if you're a Pentecostal, you've grown up in a Pentecostal church, it's after the church we go fellowship. We go to the restaurant, we sit there around the table, we eat, that's fellowship. Just an example, maybe, this morning, When I walked in where we had practice for music and all that, I had just maybe 5 minutes to walk down, get a drink. I shook a few people's hands on the way through. I think I gave Brother Mike a hug and just said, hey, how are you doing? And had just a real quick thing. That, my friend, was not fellowship. I mean, that was casual conversation. There was an exchange of affection and love, but it wasn't deep, true fellowship. That was just shallow, really. I mean, if that's all we have, if we don't have something else, that's not fellowship. We have to build true fellowship, and that's what this message is all about. What fellowship is, our working definition today, is fellowship is loving God's family. Loving God's family. 1 John 4:21 says, and he has given us this command, those who love God must also love their fellow believers. How do we do that? How do we love our fellow believers? The Bible gives us clear instructions. He talked about, if you want to know the purpose of an invention, you talk to the inventor, and he'll tell you, oh, this, I made this, and this is the meaning behind it, this is what it does. Or you read the instruction manual that tells you all about it. That's what the Bible is for us. It's our instruction manual that gives us our purpose and our instructions for life, clear instructions. 1 Timothy 3, verse 14 and 15 says, I'm writing these things to you now, even though I hope to soon be with you, so that if I am delayed, you will know how people must conduct themselves in the household of God. This is the church. This is Paul writing to Timothy. He says, I'm writing these things to you so you'll know how to conduct yourself in the household of God. And then he went on to give many practical instructions on how we should love each other, how we should act with each other, what we should do, what we shouldn't do. Paul is very practical in handing out those kinds of instructions. He said, this is the church. This is the church, the household of God. This is the church. And people have some crazy ideas when it comes to what church is. You might hear somebody say, I'm going to church. And by that they mean I'm going to a physical building. They're on 480 East Airline Drive. There's a church building, and that's where I go to church. And that's their idea of what church is. Or some people think a church is an organization. I'm a part of the Assemblies of God Church. Or I'm a part of the Southern Baptist Church, the Church of Christ. And it's an organization, just a big group. And that's what their idea of what a church is. But the church is way more than just that. It's way more than a building, way more than an organization. The Bible breaks it down into what it actually is. It's a family, the household of God. This is the church. We are part of God's house, and we're family. All right, we want to talk about fellowship. The four levels of fellowship. Four levels of fellowship. Number one is membership, choosing to belong. That's what we call membership. Ephesians 2:19 says, so now you Gentiles are no longer strangers and foreigners. You are citizens along with all of God's holy people. You are members of God's family. See that? Members of God's family. Membership. The Christian life is way more than just believing. It's also belonging. And we have that saying on our little pamphlet we hand out to visitors who come to our church. Bethel is a place to believe, and it's a place to belong. I've heard people say this, and it just blows my mind, and say, I believe in God, I'm a Christian, but I don't do the church thing, you know, going to church, I just do my own thing when it comes to, you know, serving God. I read the Bible, I pray, but it's a personal thing. I don't go to church, and there's, for whatever reason, you know, either churches are hypocritical, or churches are full of hypocrites, they're full of judgmental people. I just want to have a close relationship with God. And that's silly to me, that somebody would even think that. I'll show you. It'd be like saying, I'm a football player, but I don't believe in being on a team. And I'm just a football player. I can do all these plays, but I'm not going to be a part of a team. No. I mean, that's crazy, but that's the same idea when it comes to a person saying, I'm a Christian. And I'll even show you more where how that breaks down. But a Christian without a family, in all practical senses, is an orphan. If you're not a part of the family of God, you're an orphan. If you're not connected to a family, you are an orphan. Membership. That's another word that carries a lot of baggage. You think of membership, you think I'm a member of Shell Credit Union, I have an account down there, or I'm a membership of whatever club, and I pay my dues, and I signed, and I belong to this, or I belong to that. But membership itself, the word was originally a Christian word. And we see it right here in Romans chapter 12, verse 5. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another. Membership. If you want to see something that'll just turn your stomach, come up on a road at St. Axe on the side of the road, and all of a sudden there's a person laying in the road, but they're not all in one place. You have a hand over here, and you have blood smeared between there, and you have the body, maybe a torso over here, you have a head over there. One of the worst things you could ever see would be to see a body that has been torn apart. There's a word for it. It's called dismembered, where it's been ripped apart by forces that just tore that body to pieces. That's a tragic thing. But we see in the church a lot of times people choosing to tear themselves apart from the body of Christ. Yes. Pulling themselves apart. It's like the arm saying, I don't want to be a part of this body. I'm going to go do my own thing. And Paul brings it out so beautifully that we're a part of the body of Christ. Imagine this, if I just went up to Mick, I said, Mick, man, I love you, but I cannot stand your body. Because your body is horrible. I mean, it's a horrible body, I just can't stand it. I love you. Or if I went up to, I can find out who I'm going to pick on. If I went up to Brian, I know I can pick on him. I said, Brian, you're a great guy, man. I cannot stomach your wife. I don't like her. Maybe I should turn around. I really like you, but I cannot stand your husband. All right. How ridiculous! I really like you, but that wife that you love, that you gave your life for, that you live your day every day working hard to provide for her, that you've created this home and a shelter, and that you've decided to spend her, you know, to give of everything you have to her, I just can't stand her. How close do you think me and Brian are going to get? We're not going to get it. But that's what you're saying when you say to Jesus, I love you, but I'm not going to go to church. I'm not going to be a part of a group of believers. I'm not going to connect myself with them. Oh yeah, I love you, you're the head, but I don't love the rest of the body. Or, I love you, but Jesus, I don't love your bride. The church, we're the bride of Christ. But when we say, God, we love you, but we don't love your bride, just think about that. So the first level is membership. Choosing. It's a choice. I choose today to be a part of this family. I'm going to connect myself. The second level, it's a deeper level. It's learning to share. Learning to share is what we call friendship. It's a friendship level. In Acts chapter 2, verse 44, it says this, and all the believers met together in one place, and they shared everything they had. You can't develop friendships without meeting together and without sharing. So we see right there the first two levels. They became members, they met together, they joined themselves together, and they shared everything they had. You choose to develop friendships by making time for them. I love seeing people that have been friends for years, 10, 20, 30 years, 40 years, lifelong friends. And you see them get together and they share memories and you can see the connection, the bond, and they're finishing each other's sentences. They're just connected in such a way and you're like, oh, they are so lucky to have friends like that. They are so lucky. But I want to tell you this morning, it wasn't luck that created that friendship. It was sharing. It was spending time. It was sharing of their resources and vice versa. Two lives sharing with each other, both giving. And because of that, they grew an awesome friendship. And we cannot have that next level of friendship if we're not willing to share with each other. Here's three things we should share. Our experiences. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17 said, as iron sharpeneth iron, so the countenance of a friend. We share. When we share in our experiences, we strengthen each other. We sharpen each other. We make each other better. When we share it, because here's another thing. None of us have the time to learn everything there is to learn by trial and error. If we're going to learn everything on our own and we're going to figure it out on our own, for one, you're probably not going to live long because you're going to make a dumb mistake. And you're going to make a mistake that's probably going to cost your life if you're just going to learn everything there is to know on your own and not from other people's experiences. And another thing to think about is every one of us are inexperienced in some area of life. There's experiences that Mick has had that I've never had. And there's experiences that John has had that I've never had. There's experiences I've had that they've never had. And so all of us are inexperienced at some level. But we can share these experiences with each other and learn from it. It said, you know, a wise person learns from their mistakes, and they learn from the mistakes that they make. But I think a wiser person learns from the mistakes of others. And there's some things I don't want to experience. If I see somebody walk over, say Austin grabbed a screwdriver and he went over to that outlet over there and he sticks it in there, and or there's just a wire hanging. Let's not make it too. Austin just, there's a wire hanging there and he thinks it's a rope and goes over and he grabs it and it just shocks the living daylights out of him. And he jumps and screams and hollers, and you've never seen Austin that crazy before. That was an experience I can learn from. I don't want to go there. I'm glad I didn't experience that. But I'm glad I didn't have to experience that. I can learn from Austin's experience, and we're good there. Okay, I'm good to go. I'm not gonna touch that road. That's the importance of sharing our experiences. The second thing we can share is our homes. And 1 Peter 4:9 says, cheerfully share your homes to each other. Cheerfully share your homes to each other. Notice he didn't say, if you have a nice, big, beautiful home, then by all means invite other believers to come and see your home. He didn't say, if you have, you know, a big home, then you can share. Or, you know, if your home's clean and you've got everything just perfect in there, then you can share your homes with people. He just says, cheerfully share your homes. We're talking about another level of fellowship, opening up your home. I'll be the first to tell you, my home, while I'm thankful for my home, it's a beautiful home, it's not perfect. And if you've been to my home, you know it's not perfect. You know, I've got a garage door that's cattywampus, I've got a garage that's not organized, and I've got areas in my house where the walls need, they've been patched, but they still need the texture done, there needs to be paint. If I waited for my house to be perfect, or my home to be perfect, before I invite people into our home, it may never happen. It may never happen. And my wife's back there saying, it better happen. We open up our homes, and people get to see a different side of us than they would in this type of setting. They get to see, normally I don't wear a shirt and tie, but I guarantee you I won't be wearing a shirt and tie at home. I'm going to be a lot more relaxed, a lot more comfortable at home. But you get to see a different side of us at home, how we react and interact with our family and our kids. You get to see my pets. You get to see the way our house is decorated. You get to get closer to me. And when you allow me into your home, I get to see things that I never knew. I get to see when I went to Ron's home, a beautiful boat that he made inside of a bottle. And found out how crafty he was and how great he was with working with his hands and the gifts and talents that he had that I never would have got to know if I hadn't visited him. I got to see his cat that you don't want to pet as a little cat you do. But that's the story. Open up our homes. It's impossible to fellowship in a crowd. Even in a crowd this size, it's impossible to have true close fellowship, that next level of fellowship. It happens in homes. It happens in small settings. And that's what we're talking about. You know, the first 300 years of Christianity in the New Testament, there was no mention of a church building. A building built specifically for new believers worshiping. They met in the temple courts, but they met in homes. They met in homes. And I don't think it's any coincidence that it was the fastest growing time of the church. The church was exploding so fast that they couldn't even count the numbers of people that were coming into the church because of that close, tight bond, that family. And I think we've got away from that. That's why we stress so much being a part of a life group. We have right now 2 life groups. I think that's sad. We need more. We need more people to open up their homes and have groups in their homes, invite people. Not only that, we need more people to be a part of the group, to join in a part of a group. And that's what we're talking about when we talk about sharing our homes. And the third thing we share is our problems. We share our problems. Somebody said this, when you share a joy, it's doubled. When you share a joy with somebody, when you share a great time with a friend, it's multiplied. But when you share a problem, it's cut in half. You have somebody to carry the load with you. And we need to take that next step of sharing in our problems and sharing in our joys. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 says this, "Let us not neglect the meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is near." Amen. I want to go to the third level. The first level was choosing to belong, membership. Second level is learning to share friendship. The third level is doing my part, partnership. It's another level, doing my part. Like any family, it comes with family responsibilities. Some people have a word for that. They call it chores. And my kids aren't in here, so I won't pick on them. But our kids, all of our kids have chores that they have to do, whether it's vacuuming the floor, mopping, loading the dishwasher, unloading the dishwasher, even down to Ross, when he was just barely learning how to walk, we had to put silverware in the little thing. He could figure out what a spoon was and a fork was, and he loved doing that. We have a dog. The boys take turns. Every day it's somebody's turn to take the dog out. So if it's today, it's Raven's turn, he's responsible all day long to take the dog out. And guess what? If there's an accident in the house, We know whose responsibility is to clean it up, because they didn't do their job. They didn't let them out quick enough or like they should have. And so who gets to clean that up? It's partnership. It's family. He gets to eat at our house for free. But he has a part he has to play too. 58 times in the New Testament, the phrase "one another" is used. 58 times. Love one another. Encourage one another. Be long-suffering toward one another. 58 times "one another" is used. And if we're not in fellowship, that's 58 things that we can't obey when it comes to commands from God. 58 commands that we can't obey if we're not in fellowship with brothers and sisters. Our scripture here is 1 Corinthians 3:9. "For we are laborers together with God." For we are laborers together with. You see the partnership? It's not "I am a laborer with God" or "I am a laborer by myself." We together with. Doing my part, partnership. Ephesians 4:16, "He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love." We get more done when we work together than we ever could when we work on our own. We found that out yesterday. I mean, there's no way one person could have stood out there with the snow cone machine and done. I mean, there's no way we could have got what we got done yesterday if it was just a one-man show. But when we worked together, it was for the most part pretty easy, actually. It was actually an enjoyable time. Aside from the sun beating down on us, it was a pretty enjoyable time just getting to work together with other people. So that's doing my part, partnership. And the very last one, is loving believers like family. This is the last and the deepest level of fellowship. Loving believers like family. And this is called kinship. Kinship. It's an old word. We don't hardly use that word anymore. I don't know if I've ever used kinship. I mean, as far as I've read, our kinship redeemer in the Bible, and I've never just used it in everyday life, kinship. But maybe another term you've heard and you've probably used, or you've heard it used in your lifetime, is next of kin. When somebody is on their deathbed or somebody's in a severe condition and they're not sure if they're going to make it or not, they say, "Get the next of kin."
Yes.
Go get the next of kin. By that, they don't mean go find their distant Aunt Ethel Go find distant Aunt Ethel and bring her here right now. What they're meaning is find that closest relationship this person has and get them here. It's important. They need to be here right now. Whether it's your mom, your dad, your sister, your brother, whoever the closest person is to this person, get them here right now. They need to be here with them. That's what kinship is. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 says, love each other with genuine affection. One translation says this, be devoted to each other like a loving family. The Greek word for fellowship is koinonia, which literally means committed to each other as we are to Christ. That we're committed to each other as we are to Christ. That's the deepest level of fellowship. Most of us, we know the scripture verse, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. But a lot of us may not be familiar with the other verse, 1 John 3:16. For we know what real love is because Christ gave up his life for us. And so we ought also to give up our lives for our Christian brothers and sisters. That's the deepest level of fellowship. It's the level that Jesus had when he gave his life on the cross for us and sacrificed. And I'll be the first to tell you, I'm not at this level yet of fellowship. I want to be. And some of us, if I were to ask me, hey, would you give your life to that person? I think in my mind I'd like to think, oh yeah, I would do that. I would give my life for them. But then I get that phone call in the middle of the week that says, hey man, something happened. I've got to move out of my house kind of last minute. Can you come over here and help me? And I'm like, oh, I'm kind of busy today. I got this stuff planned. I got that planned. I see if you can find somebody else to help you. And there I am in my mind thinking I would give my life for that person. But when it comes to the smallest of things, or when somebody calls me, they really need me. And I find myself finding excuses for why I can't be there. That's why I can tell you I'm not at that level yet of fellowship. I need to be. We all need to be. I don't know that we'll ever reach that level, but we can keep on striving to get to that level of fellowship. It's the deepest level. Friends, this is what it's all about. Life. Finding purpose in life. It's what it's all about. It's about loving God and learning to love each other. If you miss this, you missed everything. You've missed your purpose in life. If you miss that it's supposed to be about loving God and loving and learning to love each other, you've missed your purpose, the first two greatest purposes in life. And you can't go on to the next purposes until you get the first two. They go in order. And next week, Pastor's going to be talking about discipleship. But we've got to get these first two. Worship, fellowship. It's not about accomplishments. That's not what purpose in life is how much you accomplish, what you get done. I got to tell myself this all the time because I'm a goal-oriented person. I always have something else that needs to get done. But I know this, at the end of life, you'll never see somebody that's there and they're struggling for breath and they're about to die and they're like, bring me my master's degree that I got, that I earned at Harvard. Bring that to me. I just want to have it here with me as I die. I want that master's degree that I went to school for 6-8 years bring all my certificates, or I was an MVP in the NFL. Bring me my MVP trophy, nobody at the end of life says, bring me that watch that I earned, that gold watch for 45 years of slavery to and service to a company that took my whole life, and at the end they gave me a gold watch. Bring that to me. That's what I cherish so much. Nobody does that. But I've seen enough people die, and I'm not seeing a ton, but everyone I've ever seen wants their closest family there.
Yes.
They want their friends there, around them. Why? Because it's not about accomplishments, it's about relationship. It's about relationship with God. You see people on their deathbed, they never thought about God their whole life. And all of a sudden, they realize, man, I need a relationship with Him. Loving God is called worship. Loving each other is called fellowship. And in closing, I just want to read three scriptures. I didn't write these ones down, so I'm going to pull them up and click on the phone. I think I gave them to Jenny.
They're back
but it's
here.
In 1 John chapter 3, verse 10. So we now can tell who are children of God and who are children of the devil. Anyone who does not live righteously and does not love other believers does not belong to God. And just go down to verse 14. If we love, chapter 3, verse 14, if we love our brothers and sisters who are believers, it proves that we have passed from death to life. But a person who has no love is still dead. And I'm going to go ahead and read verse 15. Anyone who hates another brother or sister is really a murderer at heart. And you know that murderers do not have eternal life within them. Think about these verses. Is there a believer, a brother or sister, who names the name of Jesus, that loves God, but we can't love them? We have no love in our heart for that person. These verses should speak to us. If that's where you're at, there's somebody in your life that you know is a believer in God, but you can't find anywhere in your heart to love them. That should be a thing of concern. And only you know that this morning. And I want you to go to chapter 4, verse 20. 1 John 4, verse 20. If someone says, I love God, but hates a fellow believer, that person is a liar. For we do not love. For if we don't love people we can see, how can we love God when we cannot see?
Amen.
So here's the thing. The people that we're with here in this body, that's our test as to whether we really love God. That's how important it is for us to have fellowship with each other, because if we can't get along with each other, how can we say we're friends of God? Or how can we say we love God if we can't love each other? That's the Bible. That's not me. This verse is just as hard for me as it is for anybody else. But that's what we have to go by. And so that's why it's so important to have fellowship. It's how we know whether we're really loving God. Ask yourself this morning, what level are you at in fellowship? Are you connected to a body of believers? Have you chosen to connect yourself to a body of believers? Or are you saying, I'm a part of this group. We're going to do life together. We're going to serve God together. We're going to sharpen each other. Are you a part of that? If you aren't, your next step this morning is saying, I'm going to be a member. And by member, I don't mean filling out the paper and joining the church and being a voting member, although that's a great thing to do. I'm saying I'm going to be here. Every time the doors are open and I can make it, I'm going to be here. I'm going to connect myself to a deeper level of fellowship, membership. I'm going to connect myself. Or are you at the friendship level? Where I'm already connected, but I've just not really opened up. I've not shared my experiences. I've not had anybody in my house. I've never been to somebody else's house. I've never shared my struggles or my problems or my life with people. If you're at that level, the next step is to start opening up. And I would say I'm at that level, but there's still more I need to do in the sharing level. There's more I need to do. I need to be a better friend. I need to be giving more of myself, as well as allowing myself to take from other people. Or the third level, partnership. where you're like, you can count on me. Partnership, I'm going to do my job. And every one of us can find a part in this church to do where you can say, you don't have to worry about that front lawn getting mowed this week. I'm going to do my part. Just don't even worry about it. That's my part. I'm a partner in this work for God, and that's something I can do. I'm gifted, and it's really just another step of fellowship where I'm going to do my part. Don't worry about it. I'm going to give of myself in that way. And if you're not at that level, I challenge you this morning. Find your part to play in the kingdom of God. And the final level is kinship. Where you say, I would be willing to give my life. And all I'm going to challenge you is just to start sacrificing for each other. Giving of your time, giving of your treasure, giving of what you have, even though it hurts sometimes, for your brothers and your sisters. And when you do that, you're demonstrating the love of God. Amen. I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to the pastor.
How many know that we live in a very selfish world? Very selfish. And we don't have the time for life. We'd rather sit home in fellowship with the television, with Hollywood, with the NFL, or the baseball. We get more fellowship out of a movie than we do out of membership. I just, everything you said, Rob, was so good, so important. And relationships are the most important thing that God wants from us. It really is. A relationship with Him and a relationship with one another. And not just with people we like. It's people that are part of the member, part of the body. Aren't you thankful that God doesn't fellowship just with the people He likes?
Yeah.
Or sees good and He likes us, but He sees good in us. He loved me when I was unlovely. He died for me when I was worthless to humanity. Yet He paid the price of love. And we are to give ourselves to others, even as Christ gave Himself for us. Amen? And what a powerful message. That's so good. And I trust that you grab a hold of it. In the early church, they bonded together. You know, they bonded together by fellowship. They were at houses, going back houses to houses, and I love it when I get into people's homes and get to know them, and I don't get to do it as much as I want to, and I love it when people are in my home and drop by, and you're always welcome to come by and see Pastor, always. My wife's trembling now, and I like it when you come in and you see the place scattered in a mess. How many know it's not always perfect?
Right.
Yeah, sometimes you just have a busy week or terrible things, and sinks full of dishes and everything else. I like it when I know people are coming, in some ways, because my wife about kills me getting everything ready. And when you come, you see the floors all clean, everything. And you might see Pastor Roy just entering in the back room, picking the broom up and the mop up and everything just before you get there to make it look so beautiful. And my wife killed me Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. My wife literally drove me like a slave. I'm talking 14, 16 hours. I said, give me a break. Please give me a break. Please. I was on my knees. God, just, honey, give me 5 minutes to sit down and just unwind. Torture. It was absolute torture getting ready for the ladies. Wasn't even the guy there. It's for the ladies. So he'd come and enjoy it. Everything was so perfect. It's not like that at the Roy's home all the time. Sometimes it's chaos, and my wife will say, there's one room you cannot go into, and that's our bedroom. Because every room in the house can look so great, and you walk in our bedroom, and it's like, whoa, what happened here? That's life. Amen? But a lot of times, it's not taken care of because we're out fellowshipping with other people, or ministering to other people, or helping other people. My fulfillment in life, is in fellowshipping with God's people. Because at the same time, you're fellowshipping with God. And I love the early church, how they would go from door to door, steadfastly in fellowship, breaking bread together, having communion together, getting to know each other, getting to know God, enjoying each other, not being in a hurry. Just now we have these churches that have 1 hour. It's 1 hour, in and out, in and out. They've got a clock right down, and they're going to have a board meeting if they're going to go an extra 15 minutes. It's a major decision. We're going to go from an hour to an hour and 15 minutes because we've got to get room for the next round. They got all this stuff so organized, and there's no time hardly for fellowship. And I know they orchestrate it in other ways too, but I love it when we have an atmosphere where people don't want to leave. They just want to linger in fellowship. And so today, as we come to partake of communion together, and after we take of that bread and we take of that cup and we fellowship with the Lord, let's take time to give someone a hug, tell them you love them, spend some time communicating with them, maybe invite them to your house, maybe plan a trip together. I'm planning a process of planning a trip together with a family in the church. We're on down the road. I just let them know I hadn't forgot about it. And something more laid on my heart to do for a family in this church. We're going to go take a trip together. And just to bond some more. Can't do that with everybody in the church all the time. But every once in a while, I pick one out and say, hey, let's go. And gives me a chance to bond. And I hope I can do that even more and more and more in the years to come. Just to spend that time. I always loved going over to George and Monty's before there were ever members of my church. I used to go and you walk on up there, hey, George, how you doing? And getting to know them and love them. We've been to home many times. And now to see them in my church, it's just so thrilled in my heart. But I love bonding. It doesn't have to be in Bethel. It can be anywhere. But I know somebody loves God. I just bond with them. There's something about it. I've been around the world, and I have bonded with people in the strangest of places. I've been invited into homes in Amsterdam. I lived with people for 4 years, 4 days, total strangers, took my whole family in. That's called kinship. We're still so close to those people in Amsterdam, and a marvelous experience there. I've been in Africa, the Philippines, taken right into homes. I'll tell you, we've enjoyed that fellowship. And I enjoy it more than anything else that God has given me on this earth, is that friendship, one with another in Christ Jesus. That's the beauty of the Church of Jesus Christ, amen. And so as we come today to partake of the communion, remember this is something God instituted to bring us together as one. Union. Come together in union. Amen. And so for ushers to come right now and help us with this, our board members, help me with the communion. Mom, why don't you put the drums down a point and help us today? And wasn't that good this morning?
Good.
That was good. Aren't you glad he's not like me? Every time I hear him speak, I thank God he can get my personality. So, we have what we call open communion. It's open to all those that love the Lord Jesus Christ. Whether you're a member of the church or not a member of this church, you're a member of God's church. It's open to you. We want to invite you to come and partake of the communion. You take the bread and the cup. After you've taken the bread and the cup, you find a place to pray, search your heart, wait on God. And then after everyone has been served, and if you can't come, the ushers will come to you and bring you the cup and the bread. And after everybody's been served, then we're going to partake together. Amen. Let's spend some time afterwards in fellowship with each other. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let us go. Let's all stand. Come right down the middle aisle, grab your bread, and take the cup. Spend some time, first of all, with the Lord. Go back and just talk with Him. Enjoy His presence. said, if you don't partake of me, then I can't partake of you. If you don't want me, then I can't have you. He gave you a choice. And even as you come and take the cup and take the bread, you're making that choice and saying, Lord, I want you. I want you in my life. I want your lordship. I want your presence. Just like I take in my natural food, so am I partaking of you this morning.
Truly great, I think you.
Some of you have never been to somebody else's home. Never. We can't even stir up life groups because nobody wants to have people in their home. Don't want to build that kind of relationship. Scared to death of it. It's crazy. It's so unscriptural. It's like Robbie says, God's up in heaven. His heart is broken because we're so selfish that we don't even think about opening up our homes to others and bringing in not just the ones we like, the ones that we don't like. We don't give up. We don't see eye to eye. Maybe they're not right here where we think they should be, or we think they're too good to be in our home. You have the two extremes. I'm going to challenge you. Open up your home or go visit someone. Go shock them out of their shoes. Make them a pie. Go by and say, hello, I love you. I've been praying for you. Here's a pie. I like cherries. So. I would love to see that bonding in our church.
more than just membership and more than just friendship, more than just partnership, but to become kinfolk. And there's great sacrifice that's involved in that. But I challenge you, because what greater sacrifice could God make than this? He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Not just taking this and partaking of it, but you're partaking of the body of Christ, which is who? You and me. We are committing ourselves to one another. When we commit to Him, we can't commit to Him and not be committed to everyone in this room that's a part of the body of Christ. To be anything other than that is to be a hypocrite. Don't take it. Don't eat it. If you're so consumed with you and yourself and what you want to do and your agenda, then don't even take this, because it's a mockery to heaven. But if you really want to be a part of the body of Christ, that's what you're saying, I want to be a part of this. Hallelujah. Then take it worthily. Understand what Christ did for you, and begin to love your brother and sister. Amen? Amen. Secondly, take the cup. The blood that He shed. How many know that everyone in this room has the same blood? I don't care who it is. You cut a kid, black, white, doesn't matter. Well, you cut us, we bleed red. We are brothers and we are sisters. Amen?
Amen.
Let's reach out. Let's touch a life. Don't go home and forget what Robbie just preached. Put this into practice. Reach out to me. I get under conviction, but I don't reach out like I want to and should. Believe me, I'm going to. And may God help us. Amen.
Amen.
He took the bread, and after He broke this bread and said, this is my body which is broken for you, He prayed over it and blessed it. And so I'm going to ask, Brother Mike, would you ask God's blessing on this bread this morning?
Father, so often we don't understand what happened when you allowed your body to be broken for us. But since you have died and risen again, you have made us one new man.
Yes.
In Christ Jesus. And healed all that was broken so that we can have fellowship one with another.
Yes.
In the love of God. So Father, we just pray for this we are about to partake of. Bless it to our bodies. Bless it to the body of Christ. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Let us partake together. After the same manner, He took the cup. He said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, a new covenant, a new agreement that I made with you. And I'm sealing that agreement with my blood. No greater sacrifice can I make than giving my life to prove my love for you. Now I ask of you to so love me as I have loved you. And as you partake of this cup this morning, you are saying, I love you, Jesus, like you love me. And I will give myself not only to you, I will give myself to this body of believers. Amen. Amen. I don't know if I've ever done this before, but I'm going to ask Susie, because aren't we all part of this body?
Amen.
Male and female?
Yes.
Might even ask a kid down the road, but I think they really understand. But Susie, would you ask God's blessing on the cup this morning?
Thank you for that precious blood that covers. It does a thorough covering.